Hello, welcome to Ipswich. As you can see, I'm in my summer garb. Have a little gin and tonic. No, it's only water. It's only water. We think we've put together a pretty good show here for you. Our last show, we said goodbye to the retiring Sheila Taylor, the director of the Council on Aging. And this show, we introduce you to our new director. And I think you're going to find her quite charming, okay? Melinda Vining. And she's got a good background in senior care. Anyhow, watch the interview. A second part of this show is fantastic, I think. It's the Clam exhibit that is going on at the Ipswich Museum. And we have Stephanie Gaskins, who is, if you watch the show, there's no introduction needed. We've done programs with her about Arthur Wesley Dow, famous Ipswich athletics. Anyhow, she's put together a great program. We've given you a few clips of the panel, which was the opening of the exhibit. It was quite interesting, but Stephanie shows us around, and you take a look at that exhibit, you know why our nickname is Clam Town, okay? But sit back and enjoy.
The sweet, sweet memories you gave of me, you can't beat the memories you gave of me.
Take one fresh and tender kiss,
the memories you gave of me.
Add one stolen night of bliss,
you can't beat the memories you gave of me.
One girl, one boy, some grief, some joy, memories are made of this.
Like Fenway Park.
How does the Queen do it like this?
Hi. If you recall our last show, we obeyed, I'm not sure about the syntax there, we bade a fond farewell to our outgoing COA director, Sheila Taylor, and we wished her bon voyage on her next segment of her life. But that's out with the old. Today is in with the new, and we are happy to introduce you to our new COA director. Let's bring it up for Melinda Vining. Okay, that's enough. Right, can I say that?
Vining.
Okay. Welcome.
Thank you.
During your interview, did they tell you you were going to be responsible for this program and trying to keep the conductor in line? That's
absolutely
me.
Not.
Okay, no. All right. I'll try to be good. Tell us about your background.
Sure. Like how I started working with seniors? Sure. So
upper middle ages.
Okay, sorry.
No, that's my wife's new term. I like it, Colonel,
like
rather than a senior.
Yeah. When I was young, my family was very...
Younger.
So like childhood.
Oh, okay.
Young.
All right. Okay.
My parents really instilled a sense of service and volunteerism in us. And so on Sunday afternoons, my mom would bring us to a local nursing home. And
really?
Just walk around, you know, chatting with the folks who maybe don't have any visitors.
Yeah.
And then as a teenager, I worked at a senior center as a volunteer.
Really? Where?
I was in New Hampshire.
Oh, no kidding.
I'm from Goffstown, New Hampshire.
Okay.
And so that was a volunteer job I did during the summer before I started high school. So from there, I guess I went to college very slowly.
Okay.
I took my time. I was a working full-time and a full-time student.
Okay.
So I was not in the traditional time span for finishing school.
Okay.
So...
Which can be a good thing.
Yeah, it can be. Yeah, I took my time.
Okay.
So my degree is
I took my time 5 years getting through Holy Cross, but that's another story. We won't get into that, right? I'm sorry.
Yeah. So I then started working as a caregiver for a home care agency.
Oh, wow.
And then I worked in their office.
Okay.
And so I worked at a Meals on Wheels, which was inside a senior center.
Yeah.
And I always said that that was my favorite job. We had so much fun. And then I spent about, when I first moved to the North Shore, moved to Danvers, I worked for a agency that provided services to children and families.
Okay.
So that was, different than what I had kind of been working with previously, but there were a lot of similarities.
Yep.
And so my most recent position was at the Girdler House in Beverly, which is a small independent living home for okay. women.
Okay.
So been doing this for a bit now.
All right.
And really happy to be here. And so far it's been amazing. The community is wonderful and kind. And
I have to tell you, I was, you know, like a lot of people, upset when, and Sheila and I are fairly close. Mm-hmm. And she told me she was leaving. I said, mm-hmm. oh my goodness. And so I was peppery all the time. I said, who would that be? Hire somebody.
I know.
Finally one day she said, yes, we've hired somebody. And mm-hmm. she said, you're going to be well pleased and well served. So that's a compliment from the outgoing
Absolutely.
One. So
yeah,
welcome.
Thank you.
But
thank
anyhow.
You.
Yeah, it is a good group of people. And what I've seen in my years there, driving the van and doing this show and stuff like that, is it's really a second home to a lot of people, mm-hmm. you know? And you didn't have the opportunity to meet Roland Poirier, our mm-hmm. guy, but he's the guy who he left. Mm-hmm. I think, I'm not sure we mentioned this, and I think we can. And Roland was a bachelor, tight as a tick. I mean, you know, if you went out to lunch with him, it was, well, no, you had the tuna fish sandwich, and I, you know, anyhow. So we accumulated a lot of money under the mattress, and he left, $90,000
mm-hmm. yeah.
for the express purpose to purchase a new van mm-hmm. with the provision that it have comfortable seats.
Yes.
Which I thought that was typical Roland, but anyhow.
Yeah.
Lots of activities down there, and mm-hmm.
See, it's a busy place.
Yes, it is. Yeah. It is indeed, and you weren't here in the pandemic. I think that was one of our finest hours. It was amazing. We served meals, and what made me think of it when you said Meals on Wheels, mm-hmm. and we had two vans going out all over town. With,
yeah,
you know, and it was kind of fun. You know,
yeah. And
everybody was wearing a mask, but you knew the person was yeah. smiling behind the mask. You know,
yeah.
So
anyhow. No, I was really impressed when I heard about kind of what that year looked like and the fact that, you know, everyone went to work every day
yep.
and made sure people were still getting what they needed and making phone calls, checking
Yeah, they did
in
a lot
people.
Of check-in calls.
Yeah. We could
get, what do they call those? No, check-in calls.
Yeah,
on.
Yeah.
But anyhow, that was some good stuff. You got any new ideas you think you might be popping or?
Oh, gosh. I'm not sure yet.
Okay, all right.
I'm still really getting a handle on things.
Yeah,
I've loved all the programming that I've seen thus far, and so I definitely just want to kind of keep all those things moving.
Yeah.
And then maybe once we're more settled, you know, start thinking up some new ideas.
There's some interesting groups. The knitting group, I figure, mm-hmm. Knit Together, I think. Mm-hmm. They used to call themselves the Knitwits, which I thought was a hoop.
Yeah.
But we haven't done it for a year or so, but they like to go out to Northampton, mm-hmm. Massachusetts. I forget the name of the place, but it's the Yarn Emporium of Eastern United States.
Oh, no way.
Yeah, but Northampton, it's a haul.
Yeah.
I mean, and one of the trips, we didn't get back to like 6:30, but they're okay. happy. They all had their bags of yarn and stuff.
Yeah.
But, and, you know. So there's a lot of stuff going on down there, and I think you're from my limited knowledge, so you seem to be fitting in pretty well, you know.
Got I'm really enjoying
handle
it.
Handle on the reins and stuff.
Yeah.
And I think the staff's pretty good. I mean, the staff is all pretty dedicated to knowing what they're dealing with, making people, older people feel comfortable, and
mm-hmm.
taking care of us upper middle ages.
Yeah.
I love that term.
Yep.
So
Sheila says junior seniors. And I like
well, that's
that
a new
too.
One. That's a good one. Yeah, that's a good one. That's kind of cool. I like that.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I thank you for coming in, and I'll try to behave myself so you won't have to correct me on anything, but we'll get the show on. We got another segment that we got to do with it, but we will do that, but
okay.
Welcome.
Thank you so much.
All right, thank you.
Appreciate it.
Sweet, sweet memories you gave of me. You can't beat the memories you gave of me.
Take sweet, sweet one fresh and tender me. Kiss.
The memories you gave of me.
Add one
memories
stolen night of bliss.
You can't beat the memories you gave of me.
One girl, one boy. Some green.
Well, we are here at the Ipswich Museum. Some people still call it the Herd House.
Right.
With somebody who really shouldn't have any introduction, necessary. Stephanie Gaskins, who has been with us many times, Arthur Wesley Dow, the sports thing we did.
Yeah. A couple Every of Every exhibit that's been up in the last 20 years.
We try to nail Stephanie. But this one is fantastic. This is about what, in a way, is almost the backbone of Ipswich, the clam industry.
The clam industry, right.
So, my part is done. Go ahead. Start with the sign.
Yeah.
One of my favorites.
This was an idea that I had to do the clam industry because it hadn't been done. We'd been part of some other exhibits, but I thought it's time to do it. So
yeah.
Did it. And one of my major people that I could talk to was Jim Giannakakis.
Who has been on this program
a number of times. He's been on this program a lot of times, and he also has a lot of collections in his house. So he brought me over.
He's got a lot of collections in his mind, too.
His mind, oh, yeah, right. So he brought me over to his house, or I came over, and he showed me this was one of the first things that I decided had to go in the show. And he made it up. I told him the only problem is it doesn't have an Ipswich clam on it.
No, these are oysters.
Yeah, they're oysters, and they're hard clams, hard shell. But anyway, so we decided we just put them down.
I just saw the orlock.
Yeah, it's an orlock, a little bit of everything.
Beautiful.
So he has many other things in the show. And many tales that he has told me, so I know a lot more about the clamming industry than I did before.
All right, let's start looking. Where do we want to go? Over here, maybe.
Okay. We're not going to forget Jim again, because Jim is part of this exhibit. Also, Jim was a teacher, and he had always made a lot of things.
Industrial arts, right.
Okay. But he's in his 90s, so that was quite a long time ago. But since then, he's done a lot of other things. And this is a boat that he and probably some of his students made, which he turned into a clam boat. And this little man over here is the same.
Tell me about the clams, though. This is great. I love clams.
He made all these clams. He's very proud of them. And he painted each one individually. And what are they? Pistachio nuts.
I love it. He's fantastic guy.
This is part of his collection in his basement. He probably has up to 10 of these clam forks, each one used a little bit differently, but they're all fairly worn. He made the baskets himself. And he was telling me how long it takes both to cure the wood so that it bends like that, and then to weave these. It's kind of like making up any kind of a basket, I guess.
He's a clever guy.
He's a very clever guy, and he knows so much about the clamming industry. He said, well, I clammed also, while he was a teacher.
Wow.
And this is quite an old picture of Steve George, which I had as part of another exhibit that I did on industries in Ipswich.
Oh, really?
And this is Steve George. I had them all blown up like this. And I think I told Paul earlier that one of the problems about a clam exhibit is that you can not put clams on the wall.
For a short time you can.
So it turned into an exhibit that has a lot of clam diggers. And these two, clam digger up at the top, Joan White is not from Ipswich, but she had a show here, and that's how I knew her, at the Hall Haskell House. Oh. And she unfortunately died young, but I had a lot of people tell me about this painting that is in Dr. Gurley's office. So.
Oh.
And this one shows not a digger, it's a Mike Dorsey. This is the view of the marshes where they go out. And that's leaving his boat. Most of them do take their boats with them behind their cars. They don't leave them in the water. These are two black and white photographs. And the one on the top is Ben Staples, which takes a lot of photographs of trees. He's a tree person. If you look at this very carefully up close, you'll see there are many, many clammers out there. And each digging in his own space, I guess.
That's right.
But all doing it together. And at the bottom is a Terry Unger photograph. Terry spent a lot of time chronicling the clam diggers in Ipswich. She would go out and stay a safe distance away so she wouldn't bother them, but she took many, many photos of them. Susan Ellis is another person who does clam diggers. Susan does it very differently from Terry, though. Susan stays quite far away and she sketches it. And then she takes it home and she does it from her sketches or her photographs that she, and she tries not to get in their way at all. Okay. She stays very far away. The clamors don't even know she's there sometimes. But she does these in pastel.
Wow.
This is David Stone. And he tends to do both color and black and white, but I'd say more color. And he, what did he do? He does a little bit of working on them beyond what he sees. Like he brightens the colors. And this one obviously has been done in that way.
The clamp
shots.
We
had to go all the way back into the 1800s, in which this painting was done by our most famous local artist, which is Arthur Wesley Dow. And this is the view from the Green Street Bridge looking down Water Street and the river on the right. These are clam shacks, and they were very popular at that time. The clammers and the fishermen would have these little shacks along the river, and they would do the shucking of the clams in there. But they would have a little fire and a little chat, so it was kind of a hideout, I think, from the rest.
So the clammers actually, a lot of them shucked their own clams.
At that time, yes,
because
they were maybe eating them themselves. You know, they weren't industries. This is 1895. And there was a big artistic effort to put these paintings together and photographs. And Newburyport has one that's still standing. Ipswich does not have them anymore. So it's the repetition of the roof lines as it goes back. And look at this hill in the back. That is Town Hill. Nothing on it. And I guess we should stop here for the greeter of the whole show, which is another creation of Jim Giannakakis, which he made many, many years ago. And they've been stored in our back offices for a long time. And I found it and I said, Jim, I'm going to clean it up. I won't do anything to it.
No, don't touch it.
Just wipe it down a little bit. Oh, it needed to be wiped.
Okay.
But that is the fabric, rubber, wood, and paint that he put together with the big boots. And then people have been dropping off clamshells. And when it goes away, it gets filled up again with somebody
else.
No
kidding.
Yeah, and people who come from away from Ipswich have been taking them. Because they're gone in a week. This is our famous Dorothy Monnelly, and this is a fairly old photograph of hers when she was still doing color. She particularly loves the work on this one, where you see the clamor shadow in the water.
Yeah.
She talked about that when she brought them in. This is a new painting that done by Holly Bryan, and I don't know him, so I can't really tell you much about him. Loner from one of our docents. And these are some of my favorites, and these are again Terry Unger, and they're part of her People in Place book that she wrote about people over 80. And this one on the bottom is Joseph Ladowich, and he said, I liked clamming. It was hard work, but the work didn't bother me. It's what kept me going. I dug clams till about 19 or 20, then I got into the worm business. I did get appointed as a clam deputy and commissioner, and I was on the shellfish board.
That's right, he ran the bait shop on Topfield Road.
Right.
He had the parrots. Oh my God.
And this is Tom Pappas on the top. And this is another silver print. And he did clamming. I was good at clamming. I knew the clams inside out is the beginning of his paragraph. Yeah, this is George Pappas here, and this is a blown-up photograph of him with his first delivery truck, Ipswich Shellfish Company. And he and his brother, not a different brother, decided they didn't really like clamming itself, but they were going to market them. And so he put them in a truck, and he drove over and sold them. From the truck.
Sold a lot of them.
And we all know what Ipswich Shellfish is today, one of the biggest businesses in Ipswich.
Maine Shellfish, Connecticut.
Yeah, everywhere.
Maryland, Florida.
Right.
And they're all painted
all the way
yellow
on the East
and blue.
Coast, yeah. You see them everywhere.
Cool. Amazing.
And on the top, this is another person from about the same. This is a photograph from probably about 1912 in the early part of the century. And this is Charles Townsend. And he was a doctor, one of the many doctors who moved to Argyle Road.
Okay.
And his interest was the beach. And he wrote two books about the flora and fauna of Cranes Beach. And this is Charles Townsend is the photographer, and it's called The Clammer and His Wife. And these are some women. I wanted the women because women grew up here not clamming themselves, but they were shucking or doing something else. So at the top is Sophia Nickus, and she tells this great story. Every night, my father would bring over 5 gallons of clams and put them on the table. 5 gallons. We would have to squeeze the little black things out of the belly of the clams. 5 gallons every night. My father would pay us, and this is important, for especially for Sophia. And on Saturday, my sister, mother, and I got on the train and went shopping in Salem.
Ah.
And this is Renata. And Renata did a lot of things in her life. She was a telephone operator. She ran the telephone, and then she was in business. But she always loved to clam. And again, there's some comments from her. My mother started to shuck clams, and so but she went clamming into her 80s.
Wow.
A little bit. This one is a 1961 map of the clam areas in Ipswich. And some more things from Jim Ginnakakis. And this is a town report. If you get up close, you can see it's a lovely picture of clams.
That's great.
The colors. So the table is here with all kinds of information if people want to learn a little bit more. There's a poem here by Jesse Fuchs, about 150 years old. A noble clam, the Ipswich clam, best of all shellfish, ever feeding in pastures white, through storm and night, snug in stormy sand flats, breeding, O kingly clam, the shotgun slam shall make the creeks and marshes ring.
Oh my, my God. Oh! I hope you could see this. This is from Boston Magazine.
Mm-hmm.
Chickie Angelakis, now deceased, unfortunately, and for years ran the clam box. Was that Alex?
Hopefully you can learn a lot here, but you can see a lot of familiar things if you're an Ipswich idol. So.
It's unbelievable. Yeah. Did you get yourself down? How long is it going to go for?
It will be up through October.
Beautiful.
Yep.
All right.
So, come.
Well, Stephanie, thank you.
Yeah.
Again.
Well, thank you.
I appreciate
Thanks
it.
Thanks very
right,
much.
Good.
Thank you.
Well, what do you think? Melinda's going to be a big hit. And Stephanie, we can't give her enough praise. It's fantastic. Get yourself down to that clam exhibit at the museum. I believe it's going to run, I think Stephanie told me, through October. And, you know, you spend an hour or so walk around. There's some interesting facts there. And I thought my suggestion that we change the Ipswich Tigers to the Ipswich Clams would be a great hit. You know, what a, can't you imagine on defense? Dig in, Clams, dig in. Anyhow. With that, if you haven't been down to the Council on Aging, come on, stop by, say hello to Melinda, and enjoy many of the activities. By the way, if you have an idea about something you would like to see down at the COA, mention it. Send it. Come down, stop in, talk to one of the receptionists, okay? That's how the chess group started. Somebody said, we ought to play chess down here. I've been pushing for backgammon, but you got any ideas, get yourself down. With that, we'll see you soon.
The sweet, sweet memories you gave of me, you can't beat the memories you gave.